body motion tense is staying motionless, acted on by an outside force.
Extra, extra, a dollar a copy. The acceleration of a body is proportional to the force and in the same direction.
Extra, extra, a dollar a copy. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction.
Extra, extra, the orbits of planets are ellipses with the sun at one focus.
Extra, extra, red hot. Orbits sweep out. Equal area in equal time.
Extra, extra, the square of the orbital period is proportional to the cube of the semi-major axis.
Hey, kid, here's a buck. Let's see what's happening in Neutron City today.
It's a disaster as far as the eye can see. Natural wars, chaotic calamity, exciting observations, and nobody can give us good citizens clear and rational demonstrations of the underlying phenomena.
Why, what a world. Well, I can't figure out what's upside down or right side up. Kids, we need a hero. We need, well, back in the day, there was just such a scientist. Some called him the Wonder. Some called him Professor. His students called him... Never mind. Kids, go get your friends. We're going to need all the help we can get. There's only one scientist who can save us, and we have to hope that he'll answer our call.
Hello, Department of Physics. In trouble? You need pedagogical demonstrations? I see. Outlandish hijinks? Okay, well, I'll see what I can do. It's a chaotic world out there, but a scientist has got to do what a scientist has got to do. Hang on, Neutron City. I'm on my way.
Folks, up in the air, faster than a speeding neutrino, able to leap over tall potentials in a single bound. Stronger than the electroweak force and gravity. It's a fermion. It's a boson. It's Professor Quinn Sprott.
Welcome to the Wonders of Physics, and a special welcome to you humanoid children. Now, I have been asked to help save the world, but you know, that's a pretty big job, even for a super genius like me. And so I've recruited some of my aspiring colleagues to lend a hand. Let's see if I can find one now. Isaac? Isaac? Isaac?
What?
You're not Isaac Newton.
Look, there's only room for one in there, and it's me, Motion Man.
I thought superheroes came out of phone booths.
Have you tried finding a phone booth recently? This is the best that the Superheroes Guild could come up with. It's so embarrassing. I had to change my superhero name.
Why? What was your earlier name?
Major Movement.
Well, never mind that. I need you to explain to these people how the physics of motion can help us save the world.
I can do that.
And you're in my spot.
All right, if you're going to get things moving, you need energy. Energy is the ability to do work. Energy is the ability to do anything. The metric unit for energy is the joule. It's the amount of energy that you expended when you apply a force of 1 newton over a distance of 1 meter. For example, the force of gravity on this stick of butter is about 1 newton. So if I lift this to a height of 1 meter, I've expended about a joule of energy. Big deal. It doesn't take a superhero to do that. But I have machines that can manipulate force and distance and give you super strength. I need a superhero recruit. Superhero recruits. Let's see here. No, you, sir, right there, the glasses. Yep, come on down here. There we go. What is your name?
Ramsey.
Ramsey, come around behind here. Ramsey, we have, this is my collection. I've got some kilogram masses. I have some ropes and some wheels called pulleys. So pull down on that, pull it slowly all the way to the bottom, and then let go of it when you get all the way down. Okay, notice it stays put. The forces are balanced on that. The force of gravity is equal on both sides. It takes an unbalanced force to make things move. Let's try that again. Pull that down all the way to the bottom. Again, when you let go, it's still in balance. But wait, what do you notice that's different between these? Yeah. This is a 1 kilogram mass. What's this?
That's a 2 kilogram.
So 1 kilogram, 2 kilograms. How can that be in balance?
There's an extra pulley.
Ah, that's exactly right. We've got an arrangement of the pulleys here that allows us to trade distance for force. So notice you did the same amount of work moving that down there. Remember, work is force times distance. So you did the same amount of work. You lifted twice the mass, but only half the distance. So you still did the same amount of work. But sometimes you need to lift heavier objects. Try this one. Okay, just like before, we're still in balance. You were able to lift 4 times as much, but only a fourth as far. Now let's try that one. Yep. You were able to lift 6 times as much, but only over a very short distance. So it's not a free lunch, but it does let you do things. It gives you some super strength. Great job, Ramsey. Thank you very, very much. Excellent. Okay, I've got another device to show you. I need a strong adult. Strong adult. No hands going up. That's sad. Strong adult. Oh, right here, sir. Excellent. What is your name?
Chirag.
Chirag.
Uh-huh.
Stand right there.
Thank you.
Please break this for me, preferably not over my head. Go ahead.
Take this.
Yeah, take your time. Having a little trouble?
Yeah, not that strong.
Okay, well, we'll get you some help. I need another superhero recruit. Superhero recruit? How about you, young lady? Come here. You have to come out this way. And what is your name?
Leah.
Leah, come around here. We're going to show Chirag how we can use physics to generate super strength. I'll take that from you. We'll set it right down here. I got it?
Got it.
I'm going to set it right here. Okay, Leah, come around behind here with me. And I'm going to have you put on some super glasses here. And I'm going to have you, sir, you come over here, and I'm going to have you put those on. Now, Leah, just stand over there by that orange-ended handle right there. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to take advantage of something called Pascal's law. Pascal's law says that the pressure in a closed system is constant. If you apply pressure to one part of the system, that pressure shows up through the entire system. I happen to have a closed system here. This is called a hydraulic press. So I've got a large piston, I've got a couple of small pistons, they're interconnected with tubing that's all filled with oil. So if we apply pressure on that small piston, that same pressure shows up on the big piston. Now, pressure is force per unit surface area. So if you take the pressure in the system, multiply it times the surface area of that piston, that tells us how much force is applied here. Okay, I want you to start pumping this handle up and down. Okay, you're doing pretty good. I'm gonna give you a little boost though. Climb up that. That'll make it a little bit easier. Okay. Now, kind of like the pistons, what we're doing here is we're trading distance for force. And she's using a lever to move that smaller piston, which is another way of trading distance for force. The combination increases the force that she's applying by over 500 times. And this wedge here concentrates all that force onto a very small surface area. It increases the pressure by 70 times. The combination altogether, if she pulls down on the end of that handle with 80 pounds of force, she'll generate 150 tons of pressure at the wedge. Keep going. Go faster, 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 faster. Uh-huh, keep going. You're doing great. Okay, let me give you a hand coming on down. Let go of that. Keep your hand. We have you step down the ladder. There we go. Excellent job. Let's have you take your super glasses off there. Okay, let's give Super Leah a great big round of applause. Excellent job. Thank you both. Wow, don't mess with her. She did a number on that. Woo. All right, now, as motion man, I'd be nothing if it weren't for Sir Isaac Newton's 3 laws of motion.
Now, you do know that the Fig Newton was not named after Sir Isaac Newton. It was actually named after a town in Massachusetts.
I did not know that. Thank you. To demonstrate Newton's 3rd law, I'm going to use my super cannon.
Now, you know, the cannon was invented by the Chinese, and it was first used during the Southern Song Dynasty in the year 1132 AD.
That's fascinating. But I bet the Chinese didn't use liquid nitrogen cannons. Yep. My cannon runs on liquid nitrogen. Now, liquid nitrogen is basically air that has been cooled down to 320 degrees below zero Fahrenheit. As the liquid nitrogen warms up, it turns back into nitrogen gas. And that gas expands by almost 700 times. So, if I pound this cork into the end of this cannon, the pressure inside is going to build up, and that cork will explode out the end of the cannon. Now, when it does that, I want you to notice what happens to the cannon. Now, again, folks, this is loud. You're going to want to cover your ears. Watch out, Professor Spot. Cool. So, the action was the cork flying that way. The reaction, look where the cannon ended up. It's way back here. So action, reaction, Newton's third law.
Extra, extra, neutron city hit by cold wave. Water pipes burst all over the city. Major blanket shortage. Extra, extra.
What? A cold wave? Well, I have no power over that. I'm from Southern California. Oh, if only Thermal Man were here.
I finally met my match. I'll tell you, not having running water really stinks. But I suppose as Thermal Man, I should do something to cure this cold wave. And how do you like my superhero suit? Thermal underwear. What else would Thermal Man wear? And according to my super spouse, it comes with a cute bare bottom. I even made my own cape. It's electrical heater wire taped to a fuzzy blanket. I wanted to use lumps of radioactive plutonium, but the safety office vetoed that idea. They said it was too hot to handle. So now, what am I going to do with it all? I know. I could package in candy. I have some samples. Get your Red Hots. And you thought it was only bad for your teeth. All right, so now it's time to deal this cold wave a blow. But not with superhero fists, mind you, but a little physics. I'll show you. I have a little warm-up exercise. I'm going to crush this can. Do you think I can do it? Just look at these superhero muscles. Let's try something different. It's what physicists call a phase change. We're going to use thermal energy to transform liquid water into its gaseous state, or steam. And perhaps you've noticed the water vapor up here coming from the vent. When water is boiling, as it is inside the can, it occupies about 2,000 times more space as steam. All I have to do is to close the valve and wait a little while. Oh yeah, I got to turn off the heat. Now, could someone out there tell me what's going to happen to that steam inside the can as it cools? Boy, are there? Glasses?
Water takes up about less space than the steam, and it's gonna.
Perfect. Did you hear that? When the steam cools and goes back to liquid water, it will occupy about 2,000 times less space. That means the air on the outside, because there will be a vacuum on the inside, will push down with a net force of about 15 pounds for each and every square inch. Does everybody see these little purple squares out here? Each one is exactly one square inch, so we can just add it up. 15, 30, 45, we can do the math. Well, if we add them all up, that means a net force of over 6,000 pounds. Why? That's the weight of about two automobiles. Now, we can speed up the process by putting it in this water bath. And I'll use a little liquid nitrogen to cool things down. There we go, a little more. That should speed things up a little bit. Let's see. It takes a little while for the condensation to occur. See? I hardly had to lift a finger. But that's not going to break this cold snap. What we need is a little more heat, some radiant heat. And I have just the superhero thing over here, the dreaded infrared. Perhaps you've noticed its ominous orange glow. Actually, most of the radiated energy is a color of light you can't see, but can only feel. But it isn't so much the radiated energy that's important, but the ability to move it across large distances and then focus it down so things get really hot. And I know how to do that. I'll demonstrate by igniting this little cotton ball. Well, you'll notice this little silver mirror on this side. That directs the infrared rays all the way across the table to this next mirror, which focuses it at about here. And we'll just put this cotton ball right there. Let's see if it'll last. Come on. It takes a little bit of time. Let go. Oop. Let's see. Let's do. There, I'll just back up. Over here, I have a demonstration which is called a vertex generator.
I think you mean vortex. A vertex is a point where two or more lines, edges, or curves meet. A vortex is a whirling fluid.
Well, thank you, Professor Sprott. Excuse me, even superheroes can make mistakes sometimes. Okay, a vortex generator, or a vortex cannon. But what I really, really like about this demonstration is this is one you can do at home, and so I need the assistance of a small superhero who has a burning desire to assist me. Oh, let's see. Little girl there in the lovely pink, you. Yeah, you had your hand up. Pink. All right, we can have two. Come on down. We can have two. Three. All right. This will work. Good things come in three. You know, with three you get egg roll or something like that. What's your name?
Jamie.
What's your name?
Anushka.
Anushka?
No, Anushka.
Anushka, I'm sorry.
Cambry.
Three. All right, you'll remember your names. I won't. Have you ever made a vortex cannon before? Okay, so you're going to help me. One person's going to come over here. And you recognize what this could be?
Duct tape.
Well, that's true. On the outside. Do you like oatmeal? Yeah? Yeah? No. Okay. 2-4, 1 against. Well, it is an oatmeal can. And I put a little hole in it. And if you like oatmeal, eat it all up. If you don't, just pour it out. Don't tell your parents I told you to say that. And we're almost done with our vortex cannon. We just need a piece of plastic. Come here. I want you to hold this plastic over the top like so, like that. Can you do that? Okay, and I'm going to put a little oversized rubber band. One. You can let go now. Two. This is so much fun. Now, move it aside. All you have to do is flick it or pat it. Do you think you can do that? Just pat it for me. That's good. You want to give it a try and see? Well, that flick. You have just made a swirling ring of fluid, a vortex. Now, it's hard to see it, but if we put some smoke in there, why don't you give it a try? One more. Ooh, you want to try it? Okay, or you could just use your fingers. Try your fingers. Give it a pat. All right. Pat. Just pat. There we go. Was that fun? You think you could make these at home? All right, great job. A vortex cannon. Well, this is a budding superhero size. I happen to have, it looks like a trash can, but it's a superhero size vortex cannon. Let's put it on. Get the handle. Should we fire it up? Okay, let's turn on the smoke generator. There we go. I think there's some smoke. Now, you ready for this?
Yeah.
Oh boy, that's fun. But I'm Thermoman. Where there's smoke, there's fire. And I think we could get a bit of a ring of fire. So I have here a little half ring. That looks like fun. Now I got to get my special fluid, another flammable gas. This is butane. Oh, thank you, Professor Sprout. I appreciate the concern. We'll just spray some butane in here. We want to get it all just like hairspray. I think that should be enough. We'll give it a go. Shall we give it a try? Well, that rings a bell. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That was just a small vortex ring. I want to see a bigger vortex ring, a big swirl of flames. And I know how to do it using a very simple principle. It's called convection. Convection happens when we heat air, for instance, and it expands and becomes less dense, so it rises. Then, with just a little twist, we can create a really big swirl. They have them all the time in places like Kansas or Oklahoma. But right now, being winter, we have to work at it. So we have a little lighter fluid inside our can. It's lit up very nicely. I can feel the warm air, the convection current rising. OK, we'll give it a second go. A fire tornado. Oh, I love that heat. In fact, I think things in Neutron City are starting to get really hot.
How hot is it?
Well, I'll tell you how hot it is. This morning, I looked at some Wisconsin cows, and they were given evaporated milk. The hens, oh, those poor hens, they're laying hard-boiled eggs.
Oh, dear.
Oh. And on the road, I saw a roasted wild turkey fly by. And the songbirds, well, they're back, but they had to use potholders to pull worms out of the ground. Well, I was on a roll, and I didn't want to blow it. Or maybe I do. Maybe some folks noticed the two balloons up there. Both of them have gases that are less dense than air, but should we see which one produces more heat? Would that be fun? Okay, let's do it. So the first one, the yellow one, we'll give it a try. Get our match all started. Let's give it a little test. Put it in the holder. I think I got that. Okay, Mr. Balloon, this won't hurt a bit, I promise. Well, maybe a little bit. Ready? That one had helium in it, so that one was a dud. But I think this red one has a slightly different gas. It has hydrogen in it, and hydrogen is a very flammable gas. So it may be a little bit louder. In fact, it may be a lot louder than the last one, so you may want to cover your ears. Now hold still, Mr. Balloon. I'm just going to inspect you. You ready? Hydrogen.
Even more annoyed than usual.
barking dogs. Oh, my thermal powers have no effect on barking dogs except to make their tongues hang out. If only a Cousteau man were here.
Well, he's not in there. Isaac?
Hey, that's my one.
Hey, you stay out of this. How would I ever solve the mystery of the barking dogs without my crime-fighting dog, Sir Isaac, to help me? Sir Isaac! Oh, there you are, you naughty puppy. Come on, we have work to do. Hey, do you guys hear that? The barking. It stopped. Why did it stop? Could it be that my crime-fighting dog whistle was upsetting all the dogs of Neutron City? Let's see. Oh, clearly. Okay, wow, well, we solved that mystery. Well, I am a Cousteau man, and sound is my superpower. Well, what is sound exactly? Well, what we call sound is just the fluctuation of high and low air pressures. When the air bunches up really close together, it's a high pressure region. And when the air is spread out or sparse, that's a low pressure region. How quickly or frequently they oscillate is called the frequency. Okay, so here we have a Rubens tube, and to make this more spectacular, should we light it on fire? All right. Remember kids, don't play with fire. So what I'm gonna do now is, I'm gonna drive a sound wave in this tube, and as we learned, sound waves have high and low air pressures. So the high pressure region is gonna push the gas really high, and that's caused the flame to get high, and the low pressure region isn't gonna push on the gas all that much, and so the flame will be low. Now for very special frequencies, I can set up what's called a standing wave. What that means is that the high pressure regions are gonna remain fixed in place. Shall we try that now? Okay. Oh, I'm gonna display the frequency of the sound in the front so you can take a look at what the frequency is. All right, let's just try to get our special frequencies here. Oh, there we go. So do you see the high pressure regions remain fixed in place? And where those locations occur depends on the frequency. So if I change the frequency, you can see they will change to different locations. There's one right there close. Let's try to get a better one. There's one there. There's one. Do you notice that there are much more high pressure regions because our frequency is different? Well, would you guys like to see another superpower of mine? All right. Well, we know sound has what we call frequency. What I'm going to do is I'm going to change the frequency of the source without touching it. Let's see. So do you guys all hear that frequency? Remember it, because I'm going to change it using my superpower. Can you hear the frequency change? Okay, now let's bring it back to the original frequency. So now, do you guys believe that I have superpowers? All right, you guys are clever. But what I'm calling my superpowers are just me using the laws of physics. So how does this one work? Well, as you see, as the source of the wave moves towards you, the high pressure regions bunch up really close together, and your ear hears a higher frequency. But as the source of the wave moves away, the frequency seems lower. This is what causes the sound of a car driving by to sound like... This is called the Doppler effect.
Did you know that the Doppler effect was tested by a Dutch meteorologist named Christophilus Below in the year 1842 when he had a group of musicians riding on a railroad car sounding a trumpet while other musicians with perfect pitch were recording the note?
I did not know that. Thank you, Professor Sprott, for an interesting historical lesson. Another interesting historical fact is that the Doppler effect is what Hubble used when he noticed that every galaxy in the universe was moving away from every other galaxy in the universe. How did he do that? Well, just as the sound of the car driving away causes its frequency to sound lower, well, light leaving a galaxy, light also being a wave, has its frequency appear lower as the galaxy moves away, and higher as the galaxy moves towards. Hubble noticed that the light from all galaxies were downshifted, suggesting or proving or saying that the galaxies were moving away from us. This was the first piece of evidence that led to the Big Bang Theory.
I never heard of the Big Bang Theory.
Oh, Professor Sprott.
Bazinga!
Bazinga! Well, we don't have to stick to sound waves in air or in a flammable gas. What if we were to drive a sound wave in a solid? Well, to understand what we're going to do is, we're going to drive this plate with a certain frequency. And what's special about this frequency is that the plate vibrates that some spots don't move at all. These spots are called nodes. So the sand on the plate, as the plate vibrates, is going to bounce all over the place until it gets to a node. Because the plate's not moving at the node, the sand stops when it gets to the node. This allows us to create some really cool patterns. Would you like to see some now?
Yeah.
All right. Again, I will display the frequency in the front. And now you see the sand's all scattered all over the place. Let me find the right frequency. And you see the sand bounces around until it gets to the node. Should we try for another pattern? All right. Well, we'll have to find a different frequency. You can see the sand starting to move. And there, we produced another pattern. All right. Now, I learned this next superpower from the evil supervillain, Queen Bee Quiet. And as I recall, kids like to make a lot of noise. And in this case, there will be. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to drive a sound wave at a very special frequency called the resonant frequency of this beaker. And the beaker is going to respond. I'm going to use this strobe light to really capture how the beaker vibrates with it. Can you guys see how the beaker is vibrating, sort of breathing, as it responds to this sound wave? Now you can see the vibrations getting more. Okay, are you ready for my superpower? Did you guys like that? Shall we look at that again in slow motion this time? Let's see what happens if you go backwards. How cool is that? I use acoustic resonance to break down the walls and doors that bad guys try to hide behind. Oh, wait, what is this?
Extra, extra widespread brownout hits Neutron City. Electrical grid is in complete disarray.
Uh-oh, what a shocking turn of events. My song skills will attenuate to nothing without power to energize them. Oh, woe is me. The spark has gone out of my life.
Is everybody charged up? I doubt it. As a superhero, that's my job. I hope you're ready for an electrifying performance. Let's see if we can stabilize the electricity in Neutron City. Now, electricity may be something that you're most familiar with as a source of power, but electricity is far more interesting than just batteries. I'm sure you've noticed my first example, this levitating wand in my hand. See, electricity is the movement of charges, of which there are two kinds. So using this wand, I have filled up the ball with one type of charge, and the wand, having lots of the same type of charge, pushes it away, stronger than the force of gravity. Wingardium Leviosa, but no magic required. Now, I also have something else with me that moves charges around, the Van de Graaff generator here. And I'll use it to make my minions fly. If you watch, you'll notice that they move in a very distinct pattern, for they are very well trained. And now for something a bit more dramatic. I hope you're all familiar with lightning. Next, we'll be seeing electricity at its most shocking. I'll be releasing a large amount of charge all at once through the air to create a bright arcing show for you all. And to accomplish this, I'll be using the Marx generator.
Now, you know, this is not Karl Marx, the German philosopher, and it's certainly not one of the Marx brothers. In fact, this device was invented in 1924 by a German electrical engineer named Erwin Otto Marx.
Thank you, Professor. That's quite right. Now, if we look at the Marx generator, we notice that there are these large cylinders on the front. These cylinders are capacitors, and they act sort of like batteries, piling up charge so that all of that charge can then be released to make our bright lightning arc. Now, if you're in the first few rows, this may be loud, so if you have sensitive ears, like Sir Isaac or Acoustoman, you may want to cover your ears. So now I'm gonna come in one last time and get rid of any remaining charges so that we don't have any unexpected shocking turn of events later. Extra-metallic objects float spontaneously. Unregulated magnetism is suspected. Well, although Magnet Man and I are very close friends, we tend to work in different directions. So I best leave quickly before we leave my dimension entirely. The two of us together can be blinding.
Never fear, Magnet Man is here, ready to help save Neutron City. Excuse me, folks. It's kind of a chick magnet. Happens all the time. Must be the magnetic personality. Now, magnetic fields, they travel, they have a nice arrangement here, but we can't see it, but we can actually make that magnetic field do work for us and actually create a current inside a loop. Faraday came up with this idea where if we run a magnet into a coil, we can induce a current. So when I pull it out, we get a current going one way. I put it in, the current goes the other way. If I go really slow, we get a low current. If I go really fast, we get a big current. Which brings me to the idea that maybe we can light up Neutron City with this flash bulb and this coil of wire with a strong magnet. Should we try that?
Yeah,
let's try that. Magnet, there we go. We need a really strong one. I happen to have one. Big, strong one. It's a, well, we're gonna give this a shot here. And should we go fast or slow?
Fast.
Yeah, because if we go really fast, we can induce a bigger current in the loop. So I want everyone to pick a target near me, but not the light bulb. The light bulb's really bright, so please look at something else beside me. So if I go really, really fast, I might go slow. See, if I go slow, it doesn't happen. So let's go really, really fast, all right? 3, 2, 1. That was bright. That was bright. We can make a stronger magnet out of traveling current. So we can construct an electromagnet here where we have an iron core and a bunch of wires wrapped around it, a couple hundred, and we plug it into a wall, we can put a current through that wire and create a very strong magnetic field in here. But this one oscillates, so it vibrates back and forth with north and south, and we can actually temporarily make this aluminum that's not magnetic, it's a non-ferrous material, into a magnet. So let's give that a shot, all right? Jumps up. That's because the current travels around in here and we can make that current flow. One more time. You want to see it go higher? Yeah, we can do that with this big iron pipe here. All right, we're gonna put that on there. This focuses the magnetic field, makes it a lot taller. So it should go higher, right? Let's give it a try. That was pretty high. I don't suppose you want to see it go higher. Higher, yeah. Well, there's a way to do that with our friend liquid nitrogen here.
And we're going to cool down that ring and everything. And once it gets down to this, once it gets stopped boiling here, it'll be at that minus 321 degrees Fahrenheit. And when materials get this cold, they can actually conduct electricity a lot better. In fact, aluminum becomes about a 7 times better conductor of electricity. So within this magnetic field, we can get a stronger current that becomes a momentarily a better magnet, and it will repel off the coil a little better. So let's give that a try. That was good. I suppose you want to see that go again, right? Yeah? Really high? Higher? What? With that? Oh, I guess anything for science. Wow. 7 times better conductor of electricity. Better magnet when it jumps. Do you think it's going to hit the ceiling?
Yeah.
There you go. Well, with that all. Well, with the alternating current idea, we can take these two coils here, charge them up, and alternate the magnetic field inside there, and we can show you that levitating item, that threat neutron city, and I can place that in there, and we can't see it. We should be able, there it goes. And you can see the aluminum. This is a hollow aluminum cylinder, so we're getting all those currents in there, and it's bound in that magnetic field. And if I turn the magnetic field off, it just falls due to gravity. So that's an example of something levitating, like maybe levitating trains in the future and so forth.
Hey, trains? Did you say trains? I love trains.
Trains? Well, you know, you're in luck. I happen to have a very special material in here that I have to cool down, so it's going to boil a little bit. And inside this puck is a material called yttrium barium copper oxide. It's a superconductor.
Well, all trains need conductors. I know that.
And, well, I'm glad you're here to help me conduct this choo-choo train onto my track here. I'll clear off the balloons.
I don't see a track.
Oh, it's an invisible track.
Hmm.
So we're going to take that, and we're going to make my train move around a track of red and white magnets. And it's taking a nosedive.
That's pretty cool.
And this is an example of magnetic levitating trains. Sit here all day.
Extra, extra, night has fallen on Neutron City. Citizens running into each other in the dark. We need someone to illuminate the city.
Oh, I can't see anything. Where's my flashlight? Oh no, I gave it to Raymond. Raymond, I need my flashlight.
Don't tell them my alter ego. Pay no attention to him. My name is Rayman, and let me see if I can cast some light on the subject. There seems to be a problem with the light in Neutron City, but what is light exactly? In order to understand how to solve the problem, we must first understand the nature of light itself. Light is an electromagnetic wave, a traveling combination of electric and magnetic fields. This wave has a wavelength, or distance between the peaks in the electric field. In a certain range of wavelengths, we can see electromagnetic waves, and we call them light. In this range of wavelengths, we commonly call the light's wavelength its color. But light extends past the visible range of wavelengths. If the wavelength is longer than what we can see, we say that the light is infrared. If the wavelength is shorter than what we can see, we say that the light is ultraviolet. Let's begin by examining light in the infrared by use of this thermal camera. A thermal camera can see heat or light in the far infrared. This could be useful to help the citizens of Neutron City see in the dark. Your bodies are warmer than the surrounding environment, and thus radiate off more heat, making them visible. You can also see subtle changes in the temperature of things such as the carpets and desks and chairs. This should help the citizens of Neutron City keep from running into each other in the dark. But let's look at other things with light in the infrared. For this next demonstration, I'll need a volunteer, one who doesn't mind taking off their shoes. Let's have you. I'll also need one adult as a volunteer as well. No, you. You're being volunteered. Okay, let's have you sit down here and take your shoes off. In the meantime, let's have you hold this black plastic sheet in front of him. Now, it may seem like this black plastic sheet blocks all the light, but let's look at it with a thermal camera. Why, it doesn't seem to be there at all. This is because even though this plastic sheet absorbs light in the visible wavelengths, it is in fact transparent to light in the infrared. Thank you. Oh, you can hear that. Now for you, I'll need you to do one more thing for me. Let me have you walk slowly up the stairs and bring your shoes with you. So you come right this way. Oh. You seem to be leaving a trail behind you. Thank you. This is because your body is warmer than the surrounding environment, and thus heat is transferred from the bottoms of your feet into the carpet, leaving a trail of thermal footprints behind you. Let's now move on to examining visible light. Light, such as in this room or from the sun, would be considered white. But white really isn't a color of light. Light is made up of many colors, and not just red, green, or blue either. It is a continuous spectrum of wavelengths from the red to the violet. Let's examine the spectrum of light with this apparatus. With this, we can generate a beam of white light, which we send through a prism. A prism is a device which bends different wavelengths of light at different angles. Let's see what happens when we turn it on. The beam of white light has all its spectral components spread out into different angles, thus generating a rainbow. But the wavelength of light is not its only important characteristic. Light also has a polarization, or orientation, of the electric field in the electromagnetic wave. This lamp is radiating randomly polarized light, meaning the electric field is pointing in every which direction. We, however, can filter that by use of a polarizing filter, which only allows one polarization of light to pass through. Let's see what happens when we place a second polarizing filter in front of that, aligned in the same direction. The polarized light coming through the first filter freely passes through the second filter. But watch what happens when we rotate the second filter 90 degrees. Now, the polarized light coming through the first filter is blocked by the second filter. Let's look at one more fascinating demonstration. Let's take a third filter and insert it at 45 degrees between the other two. The light now can pass through the combination of three. This is because the polarized light from the first filter is rotated 45 degrees by the middle filter and then rotated 45 degrees again by the last filter. This allows light to pass through all three filters while it cannot pass through just the outer two. Sure, there's some loss, but pretty impressive nevertheless. Now remember that light is a wave. Let's demonstrate some properties of light as a wave with lasers. Here we have a laser pointed at the screen in the corner. We can see that the laser beam travels in a straight line and hits the screen at a single point. Now let's see what happens when we take a second laser and pass it through two very narrow slits. Now remember that light is a wave. The wave passes through both slits and begins to spread out, interfering with itself. Thus, the light hits the screen not at a single point, but at an interference pattern of multiple points, as we can see here, thus demonstrating properties of light as a wave. Moving to even shorter wavelengths, let's take a look at light in the ultraviolet. Here, we have an ultraviolet flashlight. You can see some blue light coming from the flashlight, but most of it is in fact ultraviolet and invisible. We, however, can see the effects of ultraviolet light through a process called fluorescence. Certain materials can absorb one wavelength of light and re-radiate it at another visible wavelength. Let's see what happens when we point it at the screen. You can see some of the blue light reflecting off the white plastic material, but watch what happens when it hits the orange tape. The orange tape fluoresces, absorbing the ultraviolet light and re-radiating it in a visible wavelength, as we can see here. And now, one of the most impressive uses of light, X-ray vision. X-rays are just very narrow wavelengths of light. So short a wavelength, in fact, that it can freely pass through your body, allowing doctors or dentists to see inside you, or to allow airport security to look inside your luggage. We'll demonstrate this with this X-ray machine here. We have an X-ray source and an X-ray detector. We'll use this to have a look at what's inside a mouse. But not a live mouse, a computer mouse. Let's place the mouse in the X-ray machine and see what's inside. Let's have a look at that from a different angle. We can clearly see through the mouse, seeing its insides, including its battery, circuit board, scroll wheel, the plastic case, as well as the aluminum can that it's sitting on. Well, that seems to have covered the range of wavelengths we're really interested in. It looks like my work here is done.
Hello. Yes, my team is taken care of. Neutron City can relax. I'm glad we could help. Yes, goodbye. Well, you know, even superheroes can't violate the laws of physics. But those same laws allow us to do extraordinary things. Now, the world is facing many problems with climate change, terrorism, cybercrime, political instability. And I believe that an understanding of the laws of physics is useful, in fact, probably even essential for solving many of these problems. Now, the world may get worse before it gets better, but I think eventually we'll learn how to deal with these things. In fact, maybe one of you will be the superhero that figures out how to apply the laws of physics to solve one of these great problems that we're facing now. And now I'd like to end the show the same way we have ended every show for the past 33 years, by making for you a cloud. Now, some clouds warm the Earth, but other clouds cool the Earth. And if we could make clouds on a large scale at the right place at the right time, just maybe we could solve the problem of global warming. But I'm not going to do that today, but I am going to show you how to make a cloud. We're going to use the same liquid nitrogen that you've seen before, and we have 25 liters of it. We're going to force nitrogen gas into this container. That forces the liquid up into this pipe on the top. The pipe has several dozen small holes in the top. When the liquid comes out those holes, it's very, very cold, 321 degrees below zero Fahrenheit. When it comes in contact with the warm air, the water vapor in the air condenses into tiny droplets of liquid water. And that's what we call a cloud. And so with that, I will thank you all for coming. Oh, and I should thank my mother for the monogram shirt. S for Sprott.